G'day. So torture porn. What is it? Is it ethical? The term itself was coined in 2006 in the New York magazine by David Edelston. He was talking about Eli Roth's film Hostel. Now, it wasn't exactly the first film of the genre, but it was the one that attracted the most attention. It did really well at the cinemas. For those that are unaware, Hostel is a narrative about two brash American tourists who go backpacking in Slovakia. They're kidnapped. They're sold off for torture to wealthy international tourists who are paid for the pleasure of torturing. It features focused and protracted shots of bodily mutilation and torture on mostly unwilling participants. Essentially, pornographic close-ups of genitalia and intercourse have been replaced with drill bit penetrations and dismemberment, and a gory, grisly demise has become the new money shot. So, arguably the first film...
They were thinking money shot.
Arguably the first film of the genre was Wes Craven's 1972 debut film, Last House on the Left. This film gave Wes Craven the opportunity to put to work those skills he'd honed working as a pseudonymous pornographic director in the late 60s and early 70s. The rise of the genre, however, while it took off in Japan and took off in Italy, was curtailed in America by the rise of the slasher film and just the regular gore horror flick. And this dominated through the late 70s, early 80s, and 90s. Eli Roth, who's the unofficial leader of what's called the contemporary splat pack of new wave horror directors, he refers to the films that influenced him as saying, by the end of the decade, horror had literally become a joke. The term I often use to describe the effect is gore porno, where the true impact of horror is drained away and the motive for these movies becomes just a way of fast-forwarding from one death to the next. So this is a selection of some of the sort of canonical films of the genre. Unlike the infamous Japanese flick, Guinea Pig, Flowers of Flesh and Blood, Hostel in Eli Roth's eyes is a pessimistic view of not trusting the government, whatever that means. Other films dissected and tossed into the basket include arthouse films such as Gaspar Noir's 2002 Irreversible and Miyake Takashi's 1999 film The Audition. The most successful of these films, though, is James Wan's Saw franchise. There's seven films that have been made, one a year between 2004 and 2011. And they've been most commonly associated with this idea of torture porn because they combine this idea of torture and surveillance. And this is important because the violence in Saw is recorded not just for us as audience, but also for the viewing pleasure of the protagonists, in this case, Jigsaw and his acolytes, as well as the bumbling police who can't really save anyone. So the issue becomes gory violence and death as recorded spectacle. Now this obviously has a historic link to things like the gallows, medieval practices of public execution, and public torture, and of course more recently, atrocities and controversies such as Abu Ghraib prison in Iraq. Abu Ghraib is of specific interest because of the strong connections between the abuse of prisoners and the portrayal of victims and perpetrators in these films, especially Saw and Hostel. In all of these, like, and Abu Ghraib, torture is spectacle to be enjoyed, watched, and ostensibly to be recorded for, you know, later pleasure. Death is portrayed in grainy surveillance footage, in outfits and rooms reminiscent of the notorious Iraqi prison. Eli Roth and several other critics argue that by utilizing the tropes of torture and surveillance and playing them in the form of gore porno or torture porn, they're in fact making a valid statement on American politics in a post 9/11 world. But are they really? I'd argue that instead they're engaging in a literal arms race to the bottom, damaging the reputation of serious but horrific dramas such as Funny Games by Haneke, Irreversible, The Audition, all in the sort of dream of returning to resurrecting this idea of medieval practices of public horrific spectacle.
In talking about the ethics of torture porn, it seems appropriate to take a step back and talk about some of the general ways that more established kinds of the horror film are watched. Two of the most commonly spoken about forms focus on conservatism or catharsis. The conservative cycle of horror films is made up predominantly of the slasher films, most notably the Halloween franchise, and these films often recycle the same kind of plot template. It's teenagers, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, the monster appears and punishes them, and the audience, which is usually made up of the same kind of demographic, is ostensibly left with that conservative message that we too should ought to behave ourselves or we'll be punished in a similar manner. The horror films which lend themselves to a more cathartic kind of viewing are usually based on survival, usually of a single character where the rest of the cast has been killed off progressively as we've watched. And this is the basis of a lot of the arguments made by horror apologists. There's the kind of collective sigh of relief, and that's given us a safe way to view traumatic things without being traumatized ourselves. These two simple categories are by no means exhaustive, and they often overlap with each other. It's more important here that we notice that even if we do see them as not necessarily unethical or unhealthy, they're still driven by cinematic violence in order to get to these ends of catharsis or political messaging. And as well that we observe the inherent faults in the construct. They're very open to abuse, and if the violence loses its edge, that we won't get to either of those ostensibly healthy ends, being conservatism or catharsis. We're going to look at a couple of scenes from the recent film The Cabin in the Woods, which I think borders nicely on what Kim said earlier on films that try and do the bad but good, but I think in a very obvious way. And it does this by taking on this sort of archetypal slasher plot film with the important twist that it's all part of a ritual that's run by technicians. So there's a very clear way that they mock the idea of torture porn by accentuating everything to the point of absurdity. So we have a little clip here from the nominal sex scene of the film.
Don't spill on me.
Oh, did I get a little beer on your shirt? I guess it'll have to come off.
Not here.
Oh, baby, come on.
Growl it on.
I'm Tilly.
Okay, guys, that's it. Let's go. We got a job to do. Your basic human needs disgust me. Get out of here.
So this is one of the better examples of where they're linking the audience with the whole sort of industry of torture porn that consumer demand creates, the need for people to keep producing these films, and taking on that kind of the influence that surveillance type watching has come into filmmaking following Saw and other films. We've got one more clip that has perhaps the most silent kind of implication of it. Sensitized to the violence, but they've actually begun to party their way through it. Evidence which supports this kind of argument that it's a different kind of viewing can be easily found if you look on forums where torture porn films make their presence known. Despite Eli Roth's protestations, it doesn't seem to lend themselves to discussions of post 9/11 politics or anything like that. More it's just fans talking about their need for more and more bizarre and violent deaths on screen. So, this scene we can use to sort of lead into what we think are the central questions that we want to contribute here today. And come from spiraling amounts of violence more and more desensitized to it, that they can't get to catharsis or receive any sort of message. What does that mean for horror films that pretend at having no politics or nothing to say? What is the ethical significance of catharsis in regard to horror cinema? And lastly, if we begin to identify with the monsters rather than with the victims, do we, like the technicians in the ritual, become part of a broader monstrosity that seems to be the whole industry of torture porn film as a whole? That's it.